When we think about science 2.0, we think about many fascinating new possibilities of research and communication. As a result of the uprising internet, scientists have left their ivory towers and silent study rooms. Now they can interact and communicate not only at conferences like this one, but also during their daily or, well, nightly work. They share their thoughts and their data, and they share lots of publications, of course. Science 2.0 means the formation of networks which integrate functions that meetings, libraries, laboratories have had in the old analog world. Networks like Academia EU or Mendeley, for example, can be used as a document management system, a repository, a bibliographic database at the same time. If one has built up a well-organized network with important peers, his or her network would be like a library full of highly relevant content. Searching in such a network, we can be sure that we won't miss articles and papers that our peers find important. This is, in fact, a very efficient strategy to deal with the information overload, since quoting of publications and searching for content are important for scientific communication. As communication always has addressees that are, of course, our peers in our scientific networks, considering the stuff which our colleagues have found useful and relevant in their scientific work is wise and a pretty good information behavior. Even an unattractive activity as looking for information and doing research for papers is, for the most people, except librarians, or information specialists, becomes interesting. We can call this a rhetoric approach to publications, because we select the papers we want to read and to quote in our text with a view to our future readers and their expectations. This is an effect of Science 2.0 and could be a vital component of information literacy in the future. It is possible thanks to digital technologies. Those technologies certainly cause a lot of tricky problems to be solved in the field of technology, organization, and management as well. But who is thinking about legal issues while he or she is using those amazing new tools? Yes, I know, the lawyers are the bad guys, the killjoys, the party poopers. They always see problems that no one needs to have, but they do see problems. So it is my job to be the bad guy at this nice conference and to talk about some legal matters. Before I start, I have to confess that it seems impossible to talk about legal issues in front of an international audience because legal issues have to be discussed in a national perspective. International copyright law doesn't really exist. Furthermore, translating legal terms into another language is difficult because legal terms stand for a specific legal concept which perhaps does not exist in other countries. But I'll try to do my best. My talk has three parts. At the beginning, I'll speak about the law's changing role when science becomes digital and physical copies of copyright-protected content disappear. After that, a little funny problem will be discussed from the background of German law as an example for the problems we have when we use Science 2.0 tools. At the end, I will propose an idea of a strategy which can help to reduce or even to avoid legal problems by working and collaborating in Science 2.0 environments. Let's travel back in time to the 50s. Science in the 50s was science with books, with journal issues, with bound volumes in library stacks. Science in the 50s was this tangible property, you can touch it with your hand, to name it legally. The owner of the books and volumes, a library or university for instance, was free to regulate the use of those items. Copyright was far away due to exhaustion of the right of distribution as a result of purchasing the books and journals. Exhaustion is found in Article 17, German Copyright Act, where copies of a work have been brought to the market by sale with the consent of the person entitled to distribute them, their dissemination shall be permissible. Scientific communication in the 50s was communication by publication besides some meetings or congresses. At this time, copyright was very important to reach the public. Who was technically able to spread a paper widely? Only a person who owns a printing office or a distribution system was able to do this. It was the publisher who had both on hand. So this was the deal. The author grants copyright completely and the publisher gives him or her public when he exercises this right. Let's move to the 21st century. Printed books are becoming less important in quite a number of scientific fields. More papers and journal articles are available online only. This means, of course, a dramatic improvement for scientific collaboration. Without digital content, something like Science 2.0 is not possible. But wait, who will own the content and control the usage of it if physical things are vanishing? Without buying tangible property like real books or printed journals, there won't be exhaustion, and without exhaustion, the copyright owner is able to control the way we use or share content. How does it work? In digital environments, every use of content means copying or reproducing the content. If we open a PDF file, for example, there are some copies while transferring the data via internet, and of course, there is a copy in the working memory of our device. And if we want to keep the content, we save the file to our hard disk or USB flash drive. Some people with an old school attitude would print it out, but this is also a copy. In the light of copyright, to reproduce or to copy means encroaching on the exploitation right of the author or the copyright owner, which in most cases is the publisher. There are only two possibilities to encroach on exploitation rights. Firstly, limitations on copyright, which are found in the Copyright Act itself, and secondly, a license granted by contract or license agreement. The situation of digital content is totally different to the situation as it was in the so-called analog age. Property of tangible things like books in the analog age is quite exactly defined by law. A license isn't such a clear thing. A license only exists as it is granted by copyright, and contracts could be very different. An unpleasant consequence of this difference between analog and digital content is that we always have to be thoughtful of copyright when we are using digital stuff. Not only the digital situation of copyright-protected content, but also the function of copyright as a tool to reach publicity has changed. Today, everyone can spread a paper worldwide via internet, having no more than a smartphone and a social media account. But if an author transfers his or her copyright to a publisher, as he or she did in the analog age, the effect of this copyright transfer is totally different. Now, the publisher does not make the paper public in a way the author was not able to do. Now, the publisher restricts the access by building tall access barriers. if role of the publisher has changed in the digital age from being an access provider to a gatekeeper. The only positive effect of being such a gatekeeper is perhaps focusing the attention to scientists to a specific paper. That means to give a paper a concrete visibility to relevant peers instead of a potential visibility to the billions of people in the internet. In my opinion, to focus people's attention to a paper is the only reason for accepting the restriction that traditional copyright granting has for publication in the digital age. But focusing is important in Science 2.0 too, as a result of networking and communication in digital environments. Unfortunately, switching to Science 2.0 tools alone is not enough to respond to copyright problems caused by digital content. Without having the permission of the copyright owner, as it can found in the license agreement, copyright-protected content can only be used according to the limitations of the Copyright Act. And this isn't funny. I will give you a little example. A few weeks ago, I bought a new book by Jan Assmann titled Exodus. In his foreword, I found a nice example of something like Science 2.0. Jan Assmann participated in an online discussion organized by the well-known German review portal Perlentaucher. Let me shortly explain the expression Perlentaucher. A Perlentaucher is a person who dives in the sea looking for precious pearls, and like such a diver, the team of Perlentaucher is looking for book reviews and remarkable articles in the feature pages of leading newspapers in Germany and is publishing a daily digest. Jan Assmann has joined an online discussion and has learned there a lot, as he wrote in the foreword of Exodus. I found it interesting that the well-established Professor Emeritus has praised the values of internet and open science. So I took a picture with my smartphone and tweeted it to my followers. Only a few minutes later, a follower called Rechtsstudent HU, this means law student at Humboldt University, wrote that my tweet was a copyright violation. As a lawyer, I would say that depends. Let's have a closer look to our little case. What have I done? I took a picture from Jan Assmann's foreword. I assume that the text, which you can read in the picture, is an own intellectual creation, and that means it is copyright protected. My picture is a reproduction of Assmann's work. The right of reproduction is an exclusive right of the author. According to German copyright law, there are only two possibilities to encroach on authors' rights: limitations on copyright or license granted by the author. I have already mentioned it. In this case, I'm lucky. As a natural person, I am allowed to take a picture of Assmann's text according to Article 53 German Copyright Act. In the next step, I tweeted the picture together with a few words. Tweeting means some more new reproductions and, that's important, making the content available to the public. The right of making content available to the public, unfortunately, is another exclusive exploitation right of the author. In addition to a limitation for reproductions, I need another limitation that allows showing the content in the internet. The only limitation that could be helpful is the right of quotation. In accordance with Article 51, German Copyright Act, quotation is justified for the purpose of, quotation. That's not really clear, but there are three distinctions in the law itself. Two of them are relevant for us, namely if quotation is included in an independent scientific work for the purpose of explaining the content, or is inserted into an independent work of language. The work is the point here. And that is the question. Is my tweet an independent scientific work, or at least an independent work of language? I think it is not. The tweet is too short and not creative enough to be recognized as a copyright-protected work. Thus, this means my tweet violates copyright as a Rechtsstudent HU believes? Well, that depends. The limitation in Article 51 says that the quotation shall be permissible in particular. That means the distinctions in the article are only examples. There could be other cases in which a quotation is justified. The point is how far from the examples in the Copyright Act those other cases can be distant. Most legal experts believe that in every case it must be a work in which you quote. If this is right, you won't be allowed to quote in a tweet according to German copyright law. Besides, your tweet will be an intellectual creative work, and this is unusual. So be careful, tweeting is dangerous. It's time to say a few words to our colleagues from the United States. From their point of view, the legal analysis of our little Twitter case sounds like a fairy tale or a bad joke, but don't call it a joke, just call it European continental copyright law. In Germany, we only have distinct limitations in the Copyright Act, but we don't have a general clause like the fair use doctrine is. In the light of US copyright, my tweet would be fair use because it's a comment, it's scholarship, and it's only a very small part of the publication was used in my tweet. I think our little example has shown the legal difficulties of Science 2.0 very clearly. The main problem is that Science 2.0 happens in an open space, in a public sphere, so every time we are using copyright-protected content, we have to think about the law. But there is another problem. Science 2.0 happens in a specific digital environment. We are using digital services like Twitter or Facebook, for example. Those services have their own terms and conditions that we have to accept if we want to use that digital infrastructure. In the terms and conditions, we find regulations about copyright. Sometimes the regulations are, well, surprising. In the terms of Facebook, for instance, we read this: for content that is covered by intellectual property rights, like photos and videos, IP content, you grant us a non-exclusive, transferable, sub-licensable, royalty-free, of course, worldwide license to use any IP content that you post on or in connection with Facebook. But Twitter isn't better. By submitting, posting, or displaying content on or through the service, you grant us a worldwide, non-exclusive, royalty-free license with right to sub-license, to use, copy, reproduce, process, adapt, modify, publish, transmit, display, and distribute such content in any and all media or distribution methods now known or later developed. Movies on the moon, I don't know. You agree that this license includes the right for Twitter to provide, promote, and improve the service and to make content submitted to or through the services available to other companies, organizations, or individuals who partner with Twitter for the syndication, broadcast, distribution, or publication of such content, on other media and services subject to our terms and conditions for such content use. Let's go back to our little example. Assuming the picture in my tweet is a quotation, what does this mean in the light of Twitter's terms? According to them, I grant Twitter a worldwide, non-exclusive, royalty-free license with the right of sublicense, but I can't do this. I do not have any rights on Assmann's text. My use at Twitter is only justified by limitation rules. Without the context of my tweets, neither I nor Twitter can use the picture. Granting Twitter a license is impossible for me. This all is very awful. How can we deal with this unsatisfying situation? Stopping using Science 2.0 tools is no option. But we can relax. Yes, there are a lot of unclean copyright situations, but there isn't a great risk for legal action in the field of scientific communication, besides you are doing Disney or perhaps Star Wars studies. Nevertheless, we can reduce legal problems dramatically if we only use content which is created by ourselves, or content which has open access attributions like Creative Commons licenses. Such licenses are a safe ground for nearly all purposes of Science 2.0. At the beginning of my talk, I stressed out the changing effects of copyright in a digital environment. As it was wise in the old analog world to grant copyright, to grant publishers copyright to become visible, today it is necessary to apply licenses like Creative Commons to scientific content. This is the right legal answer to the new ecosystem of science, which Science 2.0 is going to build up. I come to the end. We have seen that the disappearance of tangible objects as containers for scientific content, like books, printed journals, and so on, has caused some legal problems. Having access to content does not mean that we can use the content in Science 2.0 environments without thinking about legal implications. We have to consider the legal situation of our content with the same attention as we do with technology issues. But if the content has a proper legal attribution, we can forget the law and enjoy the new possibilities of Science 2.0. Really? As a lawyer, I would say that depends. What about data protection, privacy, trademarks, personal rights, and so on? Great stuff of joy for lawyers. But for today, unfortunately, it is too far afield. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Eric. We do have time for some questions. Yes, please.
In your little Twitter example, is there another way out? You are the IP owner of the photo.
Yes.
Of the text.
That's a question, and it depends. If you are making a photo of printed material, you perhaps don't have a similar right to of the photo. But if it is a tangible thing, you will have this right, yes. But I don't make the trouble if I tweet it. Of course, I'm the owner of this right.
Are there more questions? Yes. In the back.
Do I stand you right that we are on a secure ground if you use the common creative license?
For the Depends. Most purposes, we are on a quite safe ground, I would say, yes.
Yeah. So maybe it's a problem if I want to use it for making products and sell things out of Creative Cartoon contents. Is it right?
It depends, because there are several Creative Commons licenses,
okay.
Non-commercial, okay. CC BY and so on. CC BY is the best way. Non-commercial isn't really an open license.
Okay, thank you.
Last question, Mr. Rockwell.
Thank you for a very interesting talk. I wanted to ask about moral rights. Does Germany have something like moral rights? And so at least the Canadian equivalent allow people to control the uses of their work, the downstream uses. You can award copyright, but you can prevent people from misusing your art in some sense. And I'm wondering if that has implications for data mining, where in some sense, information which you grant some entity for a certain use, if you have moral rights to prevent it from being used in an unanticipated way.
Yes, we have moral rights in German copyright law, and moral rights are very important. And there can be such a law and such a right to prevent such use. But it's not well discussed at this time in German copyright science.